The show opened last April, rather shakily, as a matter of fact, because it took a lot of the critics by surprise. And when critics are taken by surprise, they tend to lash out convulsively in all directions. It's a sort of Pavlovian reaction. They can't help it, poor things. However, since then, Cats has won two Society of West End Theatre Awards for the music and the choreography. And its word-of-mouth reputation is such that it's now just about the biggest hit in town. All of which, of course, is very gratifying for Andrew Lloyd Webber and the other investors. But for an expensive show like this to become a hit is not enough. It has to remain a hit. And the only way to ensure that is by constant vigilance and policing. Or, to put it another way, by making certain that all those singers and dancers cavorting about the stage in feline attitudes don't become sloppy and complacent. And to a large extent, this is the job of Gillian Lynne, the choreographer. Since the show opened, she's been busy directing television plays, but being a conscientious choreographer, from time to time she gets the cast of Cats together for a special unscheduled rehearsal and really makes them shape up. The other day we filmed one of those rehearsals and also part of a workout in costume. And here, with Miss Lynne setting the scene by explaining what attracted her to the show in the first place, is the result.
I like sort of pagan things. And, Cats are often pagan and anarchic and cruel, as well as sensual and soft. And so it was such a range of movement possible. And then Andrew's music is just thrilling to me. And that's what attracted me. And, of course, then, you know, the character's written by T.S. Eliot, so if there's Andrew's music, there's a chance to make people move in a totally new way. Then there are these brilliant characters written by T.S. Eliot.
Can you all come on stage, please? We'll do a little bit of cat warm-up. Cat dip.
I have to look after my work very carefully, so I'm constantly going back. With Cats, I always give about a 40-minute improvisation of reminding them about the felinity of it and that they must express through the discipline of feline intuitions, which start in different places from ours. The back says things and the neck comes up. There are strange things happening out of the ears and all of that. If they lose that, some quality goes out of the show.
Yes, is everybody here? Is there any rotter hiding behind a seat? No. All right. You got room?
Okay.
All right, let's do Finola's exercise.
Oh, gone.
We always start off with they look at me and I look at them and they think that bitch has come back again. That cow. I know they do, you see. And then we do the improvisation together and I work with them. And they think, well, silly old thing, she is working herself up to the bone as well. But it starts off, I'm called in today and I could have been going out with my boyfriend to lunch. Or I'd seen that lovely new dress and I could have gone to Jaeger and bought it or wherever, you know. And there's always that little thing, especially if you're in a show where you're giving your all every night, which they certainly do, and which is a smash hit. Obviously, the instinctive human reaction is, why do I need to go in and rehearse? It starts with that tiny little, there better be a reason for this call, you know, and it finishes that we're all having a ball.
Bounce, push away with flex feet and push. And in, roll down, and down, two, three, four, right, stretch right leg up.
I work everything out on my own body, and indeed, I really believe in not asking people to do anything that I can't do.
thank you. Was it off?
Yes, one and two. The arm came out to the side.
Yes.
Three, four, five, six,
and
seven.
And that is shovel.
With a flat hand.
Mm.
Yeah. And the other hand...
Policing this show is difficult. You see, I have a wonderful ballet mistress called Joanne Robinson. But it's hard for her because I can't bear counting when I choreograph. I'm not even very good at it. I mean, it's the joke that dancers always have with me. I work entirely from words and on phrasing, musical phrasing. And therefore, my choreography is peculiar. I mean, it's not like anybody else's, and sometimes people don't understand it. It works on its own level only. And therefore, unless it's done absolutely with my kind of mental intention behind it, it can look terrible very quickly.
Thank you. I've got an arm wrong.
It's only by doing it flat out that you suddenly find a release happening. Suddenly something happens to your spirit. Suddenly a leg can do something it never did before. You don't find that by saving for the performance, ever. So I really try not to allow that, and that's why I've got a name for being tough. Don't forget that when you come into this little circle of light, the rest of the cast are out and through the auditorium, and it's your task to absolutely drag the audience's focus into you. And you'll do that by being, not by selling anything, but by being totally into yourself, totally, absolutely hedonistic about your own body.
Oh, yes.
And the less aware of them you are, the more they will be aware of you.
Yeah.
Okay? So, here we go. His ineffable... F an ineffable, deep and inscrutable, singular
the naming of cats and explained to the audience what we as a collective cast feel about being a cat. We then let the audience, so to speak, see something that they shouldn't be seeing in a sense, which is a beautiful young cat dancing sensually for herself.
Thank you. matters very much to me,
partly because it's the first piece of real dance in the show, and partly because it was the first bit of real choreography I did. I still think it's about the most cat-like, truly cat-like piece of choreography in it. This show is an entirely stage show. In other words, I had to stage all of it because I think it's a funny belief in England. I don't know, I may be wrong. I think they think a choreographer is somebody who, when in a musical, when it's pure dance, they do that and that's all. But that is so far from the truth. And a choreographer in a musical, from the moment any music plays, they then direct it. And therefore, if it's a musical that is all to do with song and dance, obviously you're staging the whole show. And that's not to say that when you work with somebody as brilliant as Trevor Nunn, that he isn't having his marvelous overall look at it, that he doesn't, that it was Trevor's and John's conception that we did it in this wonderful rubbish dump, that he and I don't talk at length. But obviously, when it is a show that is entirely shown visually, there is no text as such, through song and dance, it's a very heavy role for the person in my seat.
She's saying, the man was wonderful when he made love to me, but I hated him. It's aren't we? So, if we got it across here, it'll be the same thing across near your tummy. Yes. I'd actually like your hand to feel your own body.
Right.
As he once did. His brow is deep. Hold it there. Boom. Right? His brow is deeply lined. And that thought.
His brow is deeply lined in thought. His head is highly domed. His coat is dusty from neglect. His whiskers are uncombed. He sways his head from side to side with movement like a snake. And when you think he's half asleep, he's always wide awake.
One of the things that has gone a little bit with, you know, 8 performances a week, which is so hard to sustain, is that moment between these two women who have known intimately the same dangerous man. But I want those moments where you just exchange looks, which is a moment of collusion between you, right, not to go, even in the round. And it's important, it's just by a turn of the head. It doesn't have to be that, though I do think outwardly.
I know he cheats at cards.
And his footprints are not found in exiles of Scotland Yard. And when the lover's looted, or the jewel case is rifled, or when the milk is missing, or another pig's been stifled, or the greenhouse glass is broken, and the trellis past repair, there's the wonder of the thing. McCavity's not there!
We had a bit of trouble at the beginning trying to find that rapport. Because when you've got two strong ladies together, doing a duet, it was quite a long time, wasn't it, getting that rapport. We've got it together now, and it feels really good. But, I mean, didn't you find that
what?
As well, to begin with, the rapport?
Yeah.
So it's difficult with
any
duet.
Well, they're very different. You know. At the same time, two women singing together, when you get it right, I think it's terribly exciting.
Yes.
Terribly exciting. And they say that all the cats whose wicked deeds are widely known, I might mention Mungo Jerry,
Rumpelteazer, Griddlebone,
and nothing more than agents for the cat who all the time just controls the operation, the Napoleon of... So, small change, I think. I'd like McCavity, McCavity, there's no one like a stomachache. No one, da da ba ba ba.
so that it's from the stomach ache. Yes. No, I think it, I want, because we lose the syncopation as that lovely push be. No one like my bat, bat, bat. Okay? And also here, will you make sure that Team McCall, that again, this is all being used. When a crime's discovered, then my cavity, my cavity, my cavity, my cavity. When a crime's discovered, then my cavity's not there. I alter it sometimes because things change, you know, and you and. Look, there are bits that you think, I know, that is not the best I could have done there, but I ran out of time. You know, so that, and suddenly, sometimes you're going in rehearsal and you look at a movement and you think, why on earth did I think that was right? Why on earth did I think that was the best thing? We should be doing that. And so one changes it, you know. And also you find, too, that when a cast gets on top of something and certain excellence develops in something that when you were initially doing it was difficult. Once they've got on top of that and a new freedom and panache is coming, they're able to attempt something more. So naturally, you put it in. And I think it's good because it keeps the show fresh.
Just because I've asked Brian to be calmer, therefore...
When you're giving 8 performances a week, sometimes the intellectual approach is inclined to go out of the window because, you know, your body is doing something and you think, oh, my leg's gone high and you've forgotten that a cat would pull it back instantly and things like that. So that's my tidy up call always, and it's always to bring back to the disciplines of what I felt we needed. I'm not interested in just movement for movement's sake. I like working from words and from text. And I'm interested in dance and drama. So I think the thing I'm best at is getting something original out of people and getting them to break barriers of personality in dance. I wouldn't set myself out to be a great choreographer, but I think I'm a good director choreographer.
All right, the only... And that was lovely. That's the only thing I didn't like is that you did it. You did a turn then, you did a quick turn over there. Don't. Make
what do you
all
mean?
Your
doesn't
yes,
have to go back.
All your work looks very morbid.
Unless your gut turns over and your heart turns over and you feel, oh, I've just got to move to that, then I don't think you should do it.
Could you all come round me? Can we just remember... First of all, why we call this the Whirligigs and why we did it. If you remember, initially we had a piece of lyric, a piece of spoken word here, didn't we? Which all seemed wrong in the middle of a huge, great lump of dance. So this bit is Deuteronomy arriving, seeing you all...
The Jellicle Ball was the most exciting thing to build and the most difficult because, as you see, our show is in the round, and choreographically, when you have a great thrust of movement with, say, six people, normally, if you were in an ordinary theatre, they could then veer off into the wings, catch their breath, and zoom on again at another angle. Working in the round, I can't do that. They have to make their thrust, and then I have to take the focus over to the other side of the stage, but those people who are then recovering their breath for their next bit are in full groove, so it's as if I've had to choreograph in the wings and what the audience sees.
Brian is a very generous son, always gives 200%, which is wonderful. Be yourself, and you enact just as you see him.
And I can't use my arms.
No, you can at the very end. After you've seen the first lot, yes, don't use them. Yes. After you've seen the second lot, don't use them. When you turn around, just a very simple...
I am pleased with the construction of the Jellicle Ball, because even on a flat house, that always seems to work, and that's hard to do in the theatre, and it's hard to do with that much dance, because that's one, there's the fairly short poem at the beginning, and then there's something like 10 minutes of solid dance. Now, in a musical, where the ear gets used to song and dance, song and dance, song and dance, if you suddenly had song and dance, unless that long span of dance is riveting, the balance has gone and the audience gets restless, you see. So I'm pleased that they don't, and I'm pleased that that seems to work.